What's up everybody, welcome back to my channel, and for today's video, we will discuss the last lesson in oral communication. Today's topic is all about the principles of speech writing. Please disregard lesson number 3, paki-disregard. I wasn't able to edit that one, sorry, and I know naman that you understand where am I coming from. Without further ado, let me just share the following objectives. At the end of our lesson, you are expected to do the following. Use principles of effective speech delivery in different situations. Use principles of effective writing, focusing on audience profile, logical organization, duration word choice, and grammatical correctness. Finally, you are expected as well to use principles of effective speech delivery, focusing on articulation, modulation, stage presence, facial expression, gestures, movements, and at the same time, building rapport with the audience. Let us define first what speech writing is. Speech writing is an art and process of conveying message to your audience using correct punctuation and expression that can captivate and influence the audience per se. It's a process of crafting a written text that is intended to be delivered already as a speech. It involves composing of words and phrases that effectively communicate a message, not only that, but also convey emotions, persuade, or even inform. Another thing is that entertain your audience. To persuade, inform, and entertain an audience. It is usually contains, or speech writing typically follows a structure that includes an introduction, body, and conclusion, which we will discuss further sa bandang gitna ng lesson natin. Sharing with you the 4 principles of speech writing. Choosing a topic, analyzing the audience, sourcing the information, outlining and organizing the speech. First principle is choosing a topic. Bear in your mind these reminders when you choose a topic. You have to start with your basic interest. Review your experiences, stop and look at the things around you. Perhaps makatulong yan sa inyo as a writer at the same time as speaker. Be like a journalist when you write, no? Watch television or perhaps read newspaper. Narrow your topic and determine your purpose at the same time. When you choose a topic, make sure that you're knowledgeable, or at least, hindi mas totally make sure, but at least you are knowledgeable and passionate about the topic itself. Your enthusiasm for the said subject will be evident in your delivery and will help you as well to connect or to build rapport with your audience. Additionally, your expertise will lend credibility to your speech. So it's important, okay? Next thing is that consider how you want to position yourself with your speech. You have to think about how your experiences made you feel or changed you, and make it a list. You can make a list, no? A list of the things that you experienced. Perhaps makatulong yan in order for you to elaborate better your speech. Okay? Let your emotions as well guide you as you make your speech. Describe the event if it is necessary for you to describe it, and if you think na it's relevant naman doon sa topic, then you can do so, okay? At the same time, make sure to aim for your purpose, no? Ano bang goal mo? To inform, to persuade, to entertain, to inspire, or to motivate your audience. So, kailangan mo pumisisyon alin sa mga yon, or alin specifically yung iyong purpose sa pagsulat, at the same time, sa pagsasalita. You have to clarify your purpose, the purpose of your speech, because it will help you to narrow down your topic and tailor your message accordingly. Okay? So again, that's the first principle, choosing a topic. Yun ang pinakamahalaga. Second principle is that analyzing the audience. Knowing your audience, says here by Harvey McKay, the better you understand who they are and what they have come for, the more you'll be able to deliver. That's correct, no? You have to know yung background ng iyong audience. Ano yung kanilang interest at as much as possible, no? Know area, feel area, and do area. Please, paki-take note itong tatlong ito, no? knowledge, no areas has something to do with the knowledge of the audience, feel area, emotional connection of the audience, and do area, experiences of the audience. Analyzing the audience is a crucial aspect of speech preparation that involves understanding the demographics, yung interests, yung knowledge levels, and even yung expectations sa ating mga listeners. By analyzing the audience, speakers can tailor their message, language, they can adjust, diba? Naturo na yun before na you can adjust the language na ginagamit, or not only the language, but also the level of formality, the delivery style, no? For you to effectively engage and connect with them. This process typically includes gathering information, since kailangan mo silang i-analyze na matindi. So you have to gather information about them. What else? Make sure na you know, syempre kahit pa paano, ano yung age or gender, education level, whatever. But not totally lahat-lahat. You just have to, you know, somehow have an idea about ano nga ba yung set of audience, or let's say yung audience na mamimit mo once you deliver your speech. That's it. Analyzing the audience. Here are the steps in analyzing the audience. First, a while ago na mentioned ko class na you have to identify the demographics, yung age, education level, whatever. Other thing about demographic, you also have to identify psychographics of your audience and situational information of them. Identifying the demographics of your audience involves understanding key characteristics such as what I mentioned earlier, age, gender, education, level, income, occupation, cultural background, and at the same time, geographic location. These demographic factors can provide valuable insights into the preferences, interests, and perspectives of your audience. It will help you as well to tailor your message to effectively engage and resonate with them. Okay? Identifying the psychographics of your audience involves understanding their attitude, no? Yung kanilang values, beliefs, lifestyles, interests, and even behavior patterns. Unlike ng demographics, which focus on observable characteristics, psychographics delve into the psychological and emotional aspects that influence individual preferences and at the same time decision-making processes. Yun po yung pinagkaiba between demographics and psychographics. Now, let's proceed with situational information ng ating audience. Okay, it involves understanding the specific context or perhaps a certain, you know, specific circumstances sa buhay nila, dynamics surrounding the event kung saan connected yung speech mo. This includes factors such as the purpose of the event, the venue, the time and duration of the speech, yung size ng audience, and any special considerations or constraints. So that's situational information. Of course. Yeah, tatlo yan. Mahalaga din. Third principle is sourcing the information. This is self-explanatory. This process refers to gathering, collecting of valid, credible, and reliable data. Now, for us to effectively source information, of course, you have to identify credible resources or sources such as academic journals, reputable websites, yung mga talagang reliable yung mga sources. You have to conduct thorough research, evaluate sources and credibility. Kasi once you indicated it sa iyong paper without, you know, without fact-checking, naku, delikado ka dyan. Baka mag-question ka, no? Magkaroon ng, flaws yung iyong speech. So you have to keep track of your sources for proper citation at the same time, prioritize yung mga up-to-date information, verify natin yung accuracy nito, and aim for a balanced presentation of diverse perspectives. Lesson 3 natin yan last semester, no? So, dapat ma-feel na ng audience natin yung sense of inclusivity doon sa speech na i-deliver mo, okay? Of course, since we're talking about valid, reliable, credible resources or sources, let me just present with you the different sources of data that is available, no? Or that are available, I'm sorry. So, these are the following. We have books, encyclopedia, almanacs, magazines, newspapers, professional journals, audio recordings, video and films, internet, interviews, lectures, surveys. Now, using credible and accurate sources of data and speeches, it enhances credibility, which I mentioned earlier. Not only that, but also it will help us na ma-strengthen yung ating argument. It helps yung speakers, no, yung mga writers natin, to support yung kanilang argument, to provide as well context na hinihingi and engages the audience effectively. Okay? In sourcing the information, you have to evaluate them according to the following criteria. So make sure na na-answer ko ng mga fa- para it will serve as guide questions itong mga ipapresent ko sa inyo. First is that, is the idea important to you and the audience? If it is important, then you have to include that one. Is the idea appropriate to the occasion and, of course, the audience? Appropriateness, sense of appropriateness. You have to check, okay? Interest. Is the idea interesting to you and the audience? Availability of material. Do you have enough materials for developing your speech? So you have to check on that, okay? These four questions will serve as your guide questions about in crafting your speech. Fourth principle is all about outlining and organizing the speech content. When you were in grade 11, when you took RWS, I bet, naalala niyo pa to, outlining and organizing the speech content. Palaging tatandaan, before you proceed with your essay or whatever speech na meron ka, you begin first with an outline. You have to start with an outline. And when we say outline, it's a framework of the speech. No? This will serve as our guide, our blueprint in developing the speech. It's a well-planned, a systematic planned outline that can result to an effective speech. Yeah, okay, that's it. The written speech typically comprises three main parts: introduction, body, and conclusion. The introduction sets the stage for the speech, grabbing the audience's attention, introducing the topic, and stating the purpose or main idea of the speech. It may include an attention-grabbing opening, a brief overview about what will be covered, and a compelling thesis statement to guide the audience. While body, of the speech elaborates on the main points or arguments introduced in the introduction. It is where you present your ideas, provide evidence, and support your arguments with relevant examples. Not only examples, but also data, anecdotes. The body is usually divided into multiple sections or paragraphs, each focusing on a specific aspect of the topic and organized in a logical and coherent manner. And the last part, or the third part, is the conclusion. It brings the speech to a close by simply summarizing the main points, reinforcing the central message or thesis, and leaving a lasting impression on the audience. It may also include a call to action, a thought-provoking question, or a memorable closing statement to inspire or motivate the audience. The conclusion should provide a sense of closure and leave the audience with something to think about or act upon. My suggestion is that provide a strong concluding statement if you wanna leave impression or if you wanna leave impact to your audience. So always do that. Now let's proceed with the traditional patterns of outlining and organizing a speech. Here we have four, namely chronological, spatial, causal, and problem solution. Let's differentiate them one by one. Chronological pattern is the arrangement of thoughts in a chronological order is dependent on what transpired over a period of time. Here we're talking about arranging the sequence of events. Usually, this pattern is used for biographical speeches, historical events, processes, stages of something, and the like. Take a look at the example, chronological outline. Here, you will indicate, of course, just like what we have mentioned earlier, you have to identify first your topic for you to come up with a title. Indicate your general purpose. Usually it's a single sentence. And then of course your specific purpose. What's your purpose? To inform, to entertain, to persuade, and the like. And of course, we have the three main parts here. Introduction, body, and conclusion. Since we're talking about chronological pattern, let's say for example, during American colonization. So that's the topic all about. Indicate what happened in introduction. Well, in sa body naman, you have to indicate the order of events according to its time. And for conclusion, what was achieved or ano yung naging kung hindi naman na-achieve. But kung hindi naman regarding achievement, you can simply highlight ano yung naging epekto ng colonization. Okay? So that's how we outline chronological pattern. Next is spatial pattern. Spatial pattern is good for speeches that describe a place or a location. It can also be used to describe an effect of something. Perfecto, most especially if you're writing a travel log. It's a written speech about, of course, yung mga exploration mo, mga travel mo across the globe or within your local places. Of course, aside from that, you can also use this if you want to describe an effect. Solely an effect, but hindi tinatakal yung cause. Kasi if we're talking about both cause and effect, then that's a causal pattern, not a spatial. Here's an example of spatial pattern. Of course, you have to indicate the title, its general purpose, specific, so on and so forth. As you can see here, ano yung place na tinutukoy? We have here weather, tourist spots, Mind View Park, Burnham. For products, we have fresh vegetable and strawberries and such. So obviously, we are describing here what specific place in the Philippines? It is no other than Baguio. Third is causal. The causal or cause and effect pattern is used to discuss problems. You may simply first discuss the causes of the problem and present the corresponding effects, or you may choose to discuss one cause and its effect at a time. Okay? We're talking about here the sanhi and bunga. Yep. So here's an example. By the way, class, there are two ways pala, no? Kung paano mag-outline ng causal part. Pattern or cause and effect pattern. Una, you can simply highlight muna yung mga causes and then discuss it, and then afterwards, proceed ka na with the effects. Or, pwede namang nakahiwalay sila. Okay, separated. Say for example, problem 1, its cause and an effect, and then problem 2, its cause and an effect. So, either or lang sa dalawa. Okay? Next, we have problem-solution. The problem and solution pattern is used to present a number of problems and their solutions. Here, you may choose to present all the problem first and solutions later, or you may choose to discuss each problem and their solution one at a time. Parang sa cause and effect lang. Either or lang dun sa dalawa. Okay, perfect to class sa mga academic papers such as action research, research paper, not only that, but also in project proposal, no? Pinaka the best, project proposal, or in Tagalog, that's why we called panukalang papel. Okay, so here's an example outline for problem-solution pattern. Just like what I have said, pwede mong unahin muna problems, ilatag, and then afterwards, you proceed with yung solution natin. Okay? That's it. That's how we outline problem-solution pattern. That concludes our discussion for this day. I hope you learned something today. Please do accomplish your final essay or your draft. Your final essay. And don't forget to submit it on Monday para sa mga handle ko, no? Sa mga handle ko, STEM students, most especially Nehemiah, Ephraim and Alicia, I wasn't able to meet you face-to-face, but please do submit your essay and outline
on Monday after your examination. And then please do read my instructions sa ating GCR regarding on how to submit your recorded extemporaneous speech. Lahat ng instructions ay nandoon po sa GCR. Please follow ng mabuti para po hindi tayo maguluhan sa pagpasa. Okay? If you have further concern or question about our topic or your final requirement in OCC, please do drop your message sa ating official group chat. Okay, that's all for today. Thank you so much and goodbye.